Dear students, welcome to the knowledge series on disk scheduling. Now, the scheduling means to improve the speed of the systems. Now, here disk means the secondary storage device in the form of a disk that you can able to see. And if this disk can able to meet that particular schedule in appropriate time, that's how we term the disk scheduling. Or in another word, disk scheduling means to improve the average disk service time. That is what we have. So disk scheduling is done by the operating system to schedule the input output request arriving from the disk. So basically in the operating systems we are using this particular disk or the secondary storage data, and these data are coming to the is being moved to the primary memory based on the demand, and that is also in the form of a queue. So here if you try to see the figure, on the first figure you can see that there is a platter or a single or a multiple circular surface you can able to see. That is the disk structure. There is a track is there. That is what a track is being shown, and that is in a cylindrical form. There is a sector is being shown, and this disk is being held with the certain structure. That is a spindle, and that is what we term it is as, and that spindle try to rotate the arm movement, and there is a fixed head will be there. That is the which is holding at this particular holding across the each disk as to trace out where that particular data is residing in a cylindrical and in which sector, and this one rotates in a aerodynamic gags. So in that particular order it is rotating, and this can be removable or in a non-removable fashions. So there is a platter is there. You can see a track, and this particular things is shown in the form of a sector, and this is a blocker which can able to this, and here is a the sector is shown in the form of a shades, and this particular things is nothing but a disk head, and this is nothing but a disk arm. This is arm, head, arm, head, arm, head. So that is how this particular disk is being rotating. Now here if you try to see the disk storage structure, disk storage structure is consisting of certain components. That means the components for making that particular disk service, that means this disk service is based on these components. What are those components? One is the setup time. Another is the seek time, and third is nothing but it's the rotational time, and fourth is a transfer or a wrap up time. So this is the certain things. Sometimes we make the transfer time and wrap up time separately. So setup time, or in other word, disk delay or in a queuing. Another is a seek time, rotational time, and transfer times. So the method to see that we can optimize the seek time, and but make no attempt to see that the total time, that is the total disk response time, should increase. We should minimize to an extent. The ideal method to optimize the total time and the controller, it depend upon the design structures of that particular hard disk or the technology. Today we have a different type of a technology like a SATA, serial advanced technology attachment, or a PATA, parallel ATA, SSD, solid state devices, which often used by the many modern computers, and people used to even try to convert the hard disk to the SATA. So disk scheduling is very important here. If you try to see the disk access time is nothing but seek time per plus rotational latency plus transfer time. And what is this disk delay? disk delay, if you want to understand, because in the operating system, all devices are linked in the form of a queue. And the access is termed as a seek time. And the increase in the seek time, what will happen? The systems will slow down. And the disk scheduling algorithm is needed to see that this particular seek time can able to minimize to an extent. That means it should be very fast. So the disk scheduling algorithm use these particular terms. Now here let us see this term disk response time or the disk delay or a queuing time. Actually it means that it is the average of time spent by a request waiting to perform the input output operations. So that is the things what we see in the case of a the first things, that is the disk delay or in the queuing. Now the second part is the rotational latency. It means rotational latency is nothing but the time it take for the desired sector of the disk to rotate into a portions to access the read write head. So that means and this is rotating. So how it is able to access, so that is what it depends upon. So it is the time it takes for the transfer of a data that depend on the rotational speed of the disk and a number of bytes it can transfer. More the byte it has to serve, more the time the disk has to rotate. And third is the seek time. Seek time means it is the time it taken to locate the disk arm to a specified track where the data to read or a write. That means if the time taken by the particular head to identify locate that where that particular data is residing, if it is taking lot of time, then it will reduce the system's performance. So that's why it is the time it take to locate the disk arm and to a specified track. So on the track only it is going to identify. So what is the track? Track is this place. So in this track, where it is there, where the data is to be read or a write, that is how the disk speed is being identified. And finally, about the transfer data, it is the time taken to transfer the data that depend upon the rotational speed of the disk and the number of bytes transfer. So that is what we see in the case of a transfer data. So we have seen the disk response time, that is one, rotational latency, and seek time, as well as the transfer time. Now based on this, the disk scheduling we are going to plan. So why the disk scheduling is it is important? Because when you go for a multiple input output request, then there should be a planning of the process, because the operating system should not see that want to see that the minimum waiting queue should exist. So that's how the system performance can enhance or the utilizations can improve. And if a multiple request comes, then there will be a great amount of a disk arm movement, more data if you want to search. And if hard drives are normally a softer are slower, but if you go with the modern like SSD or a SATA, then the systems can able to retrieve much faster, because their physical movement is zero, almost all zero, or if I can put it as it's a zero in the case of a SATA, because it's a solid state device, just like a memory. So there you can recover very fast. So under the disk scheduling, we are seeing that FCF, some of the terms like FCFS, then you are having a SSTF, we are having a SCAN. FCFS actually, or you can put it as FIF or FCMA, first come, first serve. That is first in, first out. That also you can, some people used to terms. SSTF is nothing but the shortest seek time first. And SCAN is basically a elevator form of a scan. So this particular scheduling is exactly like this C-SCAN. That is elevator scan, and the second one is a circular scan. And then we have a look algorithm and we have a C look algorithm. So these are the four type of algorithm structures that we come across. Now let us see this particular form of each algorithm's behavioral patterns. Now let us see the first. Now if you see about the first come first serve scheduling algorithm, in this algorithms the this is the simplest form of algorithm because it follows based on the based on the request of the input output request, the head will move. So if the heads want 10, 20, 30, 40, then 25, the head will move according to that one. So that's it's a randomized form of a movement. So that's why the process request sequentially based on the input output, and it's a fair to all process and approach a random scheduling in performance if there are many processes. But in the first come first serve case, if the movement is random, that means say for example 10, 20, 30, 5, then 60, 70, 80, that is okay. But if you say 10, 25, 60, 30, like that, then so many randomized things take place. So automatically the disk will be get the rotational disk may find a warm up, and not only that one, it's a mechanical part, so there are chances that it will wear out. So these things will reduce the life of the disk. But and moreover, the latency on the search time, seek time will also increase. So that's how the performance of the disk scheduling will fall. So that's how I was talking about the disk scheduling performance. But when you talk about FIFO, in a normal sequence, it is okay. So that is what the advantage is, that every request gets a fair chance, and there is no much postponement. But the disadvantage is that it will not able to improvise the seek time, and may not get the best possible services only based on that request. Suppose an interrupt comes, multiple interrupt comes, then this particular scheduling with respect to that disk search will be also increase the seek times, thereby the performance will reduce. The next is nothing but a shortest service seek time first, that is the SSTF. Now here in this particular case, what is going to happen is that the SSTF request will look for the shortest time to execute. So shortest time is nothing but the seek time is calculated based on the queue and as well as based on the delay that is being existing between the one input to the next input. So that's the thing is that. So if you try to see here, select the disk input output request that arrives, that requires at least a movement of with the least movement of the disk arm from the current location. So that means suppose for example it is starting from 100. So from 100 it will start, it will if the next is say 90, so it will go from 100 to 90, and after that the another one is 80 standing here, and another after 90 and another one is standing 95 here, and another one is 80. So instead of going to 80, it will go to 95. That means it will look, it will try to measure the input output request and the movement with respect to the next input output request. Is it very small value, or it, if the durations is, or the seek time is small or not. So the if the minimum seek time is there, thereby it will keep on rotating. So that is what here you can see. Even if it is a randomized, it will look for the one starting point to the next one. Is it smaller to the two value which is on the either side of the starting point? So whichever is small, it will be taking. So this is the advantage, is that here the average response time will decrease, throughput will increase in this case. Disadvantage is that the overhead of the seek time is just like the case I have spoken about FCFS. And in this case, starvations may prevail. Starvation is an issue whenever the process is standing in a queue for a long time. And so that's why that is that will cause, because if the higher seek time exists, and there is a high variation in the response time in this case. That is what we see. Now, when you talk about a scan or an elevator is that instead of following like FCFS or like the case with respect to the SSTF, it will go in a way that if it will start from one end to the one end, then it will go to the other end. That is how the arm movement is in one direction only, satisfying all outstanding requests until it reaches to the last track in the direction. So if the request for the last track, even if it is the first, it will not bother. It will go to one side and then it will reach to the other side. And when we talk about a C-scan, if you look across C-scan, the advantage, S-scan advantage is that one. In this case, since it is going one side and then to the another side, so the random movement has been reduced, so the high throughput will be, it will exist, that is the advantage. And there will be low variations and of the response time, and average response time will be improved. The disadvantage is that if the variation between this and this is small, even if it goes like this one, and the last the one which is waiting for a long time, it will go into a starving. So that is the one disadvantage in the case of a S scan. And a C scan is nothing but it is exactly opposite. But only the thing is that it will start exactly like this way. But instead of counting from here, it will go first to the boundary and it will go exactly that. Exactly, and it will continue. That means it will continue on one direction for every time. So that's how this particular C-scan is going. So the advantage is that it is more uniform, and wait time in this case is improved as compared to the S-scan. And here the disadvantage is that long waiting time for the request for locations for the disk arm. It just like the other C-scan, but as compared to C-scan, C-scan has to wait for a long time, because this delay is what I mean to say. Now finally, we will see the disk scheduling policies. Now here I have shown the four different policies, FIFO or FCFS, SSTF, S-scan, C-scan. Here you try to see this thing, next track as assessed. So this is the track accessing, and this is the track traversed is shown. Now that means first track, if it will go like this, 55 starting track is, track is 100. So let us take the something like a 100 is shown here. So what I mean to say is that the track it has accessed. Now here if you try to see, if this is the order, so it will always go in this order. First it will start from which come first. So 55. So 55 is accessed first, then 58, 39, 118, 90, 100, 150, 158. So this is how it is going to travel. That is I mean to say. So 100 minus 55, 100 minus 100 minus 55 is 45. That means it started from 100. So how much number it has traversed? 45. Now after reaching to the 55, it has gone to 58, 3. From 58, it has gone to 39. That means 19. From 39, it has gone to 18. So that is 25 different. 18 to 90, that is 72 different. 90 to 100, 90 to 160, 70, then 160 to 150, 100, 150 to 38, 112, then 138 to 184, 146. So if you add it, 55.3 is nothing but the average. You can take the average of that one, the total divided by the number of track it has to access. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So total divided by 9. Now if you look across the SSTF, SSTF what it does is that it will look for the smallest distance. So if you try to see 100 will look for the among this one which is the closest to 100. So the 90 is closest, so it is taken 90. Then after 90 it is looking for which is next. After 90 the next will be 58, or the one which is greater than 90. Greater than 90 is which one values? The greater than 90 will be the value is 150. So but 150 minus 90, if you take it that is 60, but 90 minus 55, so if you look it across this particular case, it is 35. So that difference it is coming. So that's why with respect to 100, I have to say 100 minus 90 is only 10, but 100 minus if next is 150 will be on the higher side, so it is 50. So it is better to go by taking 90, and after 90 will again look with respect to who is next. So it will find the 58, because next lower side is 58, higher side is 150. 150 is more high, more values. So like that you can draw this you can derive this tracks and as well as corresponding delays or the seek time. So that is what is being shown here. Here the algorithms comes average as a 27.5. Now SC scan is what it doing. It will go to one side. Now you see that from 100 it has gone to 150, then it has gone to higher value 160, 184. Then after that, that means it has come like this to one side, and from here it is if you try to see that one, it is going in a lesser value. So suppose if this has come to here higher value, after that it is going in the lesser value. You can see from here to here higher value, from here it is lesser than. That is known as S scan. Now when you look across a C scan is what is done. It start with the just like this 150, 160, 184. It has come like this, but after that it has directly shift here, and then again it has started with the lower to higher. See, lower value to higher value. Here you have got 35.8. So among all these things, you are finding the average seek time in this case of SSTF is smallest. That is 27.5. Highest is nothing but FCFS algorithms. So these are nothing but the discussion with respect to the algorithms on the scheduling algorithm. And I believe that this concept is clear to you, and with this I conclude here.